Okay, glad to have you all here this morning. Nice to have Mitch's mom here today, Gina, fellow Italian. She's always good. Bob's in the house today, glad to have you here from Kirkwood. And everybody else is here. Let's see. I just have a couple announcements. Best stewards available, again. Next Sunday, quarterly conference will meet after church to approve the annual conference report. February is Food Pantry Month. We'll support our friends up at the Montdale Methodist Church with their food pantry. And congratulations to Kevin and Mary Jane Hunter Esch. Who were married right here yesterday. And congratulations to the family and everybody involved. It was a great day. Our buddy Glenn has something he wants to share with us. Glenn, if you would.
Howdy, y'all. Glenn with two N's here. Next Friday, about noonish, if y'all want to do something good, I'm loading a truck, moving over to Erie, Pennsylvania area, where the truck going to a storage locker in Jamestown area. And so anybody need help, there'll be pizza. And if you do need assistance financially, I'll give that. But there will be, for sure, pizza. I mean, I make sure the pizza's like pile. When I order a pizza, I want to make sure, you know, I want to see stuff. So, so anyway, about noonish, all the address. If you know where Falcon Nest is, up there, the party place, the upper street is Hudson Street, a half block toward Carbondale, or north, whatever. On the right side, there's a bunch of American flags along the curb, so it's easy to spot, real easy, you know. So anyway, about noonish next Friday. Thank y'all.
So you're loading a van, right?
I'll be loading a truck, a small truck.
Okay, and what furniture or just?
Just stuff out of the totes.
Totes?
The garage, well, basically.
Okay, so it's all in the garage?
Basically, yes.
Okay, good. Yeah. Okay. All right, let's see what we have here for announcements. We got special music today. It's actually Susan, Debbie, Beth, and Barb. So there's four of them. Can't call them the four tops. That's been taken. Four seasons is gone. Four horsemen of the apocalypse. I thought about DSB square, but I don't know. I'm going to have an inspiration to give them a correct name. So until you sing, you're not going to get named. That's where we are with that. Kelly French, that's one of my cousins up in Connecticut. She has COVID, and so she's doing okay, you know, getting her through it. I should say Rick's sister Mary Jo's here with us today. That's a pleasure to have you. Let's see. Michelle Morcom is not very good. She really needs hospice care. They wanted to take her up to Hospice St. John's up there in Dunmore, but she's tested positive for COVID, so they can't really bring her to the institution. So they're going to be visiting her at home, doing home hospice, but the cancer is in her bones. It's in the lymph nodes. It's all through. So Michelle Morcom, we really need to pray for her. She is in a very difficult situation, shall we say. And Streetsboro, Ohio, Church of the Week, Chris Kuzma's their pastor. Jose and Pam Munoz of Guatemala, the Utah Lawn School, they're the missionaries of the week. Mary Buckingham's the senior of the week. Anybody else ought to be added to our prayer list here this morning? Yeah, Rick.
My niece's
Rick's nephew, Jesus.
Yep.
He was running a tractor, had a chain hooked to, it sounds like a tree stump or something, and either the chain snapped or the stump snapped, shot back and hit him in the back of the head. And so he is very, very serious condition. And is he going to make it, or do we, Rick?
What's that?
Is he going to make it?
As what they say is, they're just keeping him, you know, everything going so they can take his organs.
So, again, he sounds like he's on his way out. But you say he knows the Lord, right?
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Okay, so that's good news. Anybody else? All right, glad you're all here today. Here's what we'll do. Let's turn in our hymnals. We'll sing number 31. Now let's all stand as we sing. Of divine all loves in excelling, joy of heaven to earth come down. It's in us thy humble dwelling, all thy faithful mercies crown.
Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes.
Okay, is it just a repeat? Y'all may be seated. That will be our antiphonal song of the day. Is there a second verse? There probably is, right?
It's three in the hymnal.
You need the hymnal for that?
Is that right?
No.
Nice to have Wikipedia in your family. No, I'm telling you what. Him and my brother David, you know everything. And that's not an insult, that's a compliment. Let us, a word of prayer. Father, thank you so much for this day and the blessings of it. And our Heavenly Father, how simple the words of the song, but how absolutely life-changing to know that the God of heaven and earth created all things, spoke all things into existence, sustains all things by the word of his power, Jesus Christ, in whom dwells all authority in heaven and on earth. All authority in heaven is Jesus's. All authority on earth is his. And the word from heaven, the word from his very lips, are that he loves us. Father, would you speak to us about that? We are loved by the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That should give us confidence, assurance, clarity, power, and hope. Lord, help us walk with this great Jesus and become like him. Learn about him. Watch him. Meditate on his behavior and incorporate his attitudes and his values into our lives. Not only will our life be immeasurably better, but the world will be as well. Thank you so much for these things, Lord. Father, we got names on our prayer list here of people who are in very serious jeopardy. So we think of Rick's nephew, Jesus, and we ask you to put your hand upon him. And you know the situation far better than we do. It is very unlikely that we could communicate with him and that he might understand. But Father, you're not limited by our limitations. We pray that you would speak to this man's heart. Comfort him, assure him, prepare this world, prepare your place for him, and take him in the right time. And frankly, Father, we bring Michelle Morgan before you as well. And we know, Lord, from the situation that unless something really miraculous takes place in a very short period of time, she too is going to go to be with you. We ask you to put your hand upon her and soothe and comfort her heart. We pray that you draw the people around her that need to really let her know that they love her and that they care for her. We pray, our Heavenly Father, that her last days here in this world might be grand and glorious as she looks forward to going home with you. Lord, we have a lot of names on the prayer list of people recovering from various things. We ask you to put your healing hand upon each and every one. We ask you for guidance and wisdom and direction in our own lives. Our Heavenly Father, speak to our hearts about the things that are truly important. Speak to us about our attitudes and about our values and the approaches we have to different things. Lord, we would like to be like Christ. And that's a project that's going to take the rest of our days. But it's something that we're working on, and we ask you to continue to patiently work with us. We pray for the Streetsboro Higher Church and our friend Chris Kuzma out there. We ask your deepest and richest blessing upon these folk. May they sense your presence and power in and out of worship all day long, every day of the week. Jose and Pam Munoz and the work going on in Guatemala, we're grateful for the Utah Lions School and for the privilege of being a part of funding and sharing in that. We pray that that school might continue to prosper and that these kids might not only learn a trade, not only learn how to function in society, but we pray, Father, that they might come to know you and walk with you here in this world. Our friend Mary Buckingham, we're so grateful that she can live at home with her family and feel comfortable and safe, delightful person. We ask your blessing upon her today and every day. We pray for all our seniors, Lord, they likewise might have all the things that they need taken care of and that they might be able to enjoy their days here in this world and know there's purpose. There's a reason they're here. And that might be just praying for children, great-grandchildren, grandchildren, the world around us, whatever it may be. Our Heavenly Father, we commend them to you, all our seniors, the United States Armed Forces, law enforcement agencies, our government. We commend them all to you and ask you to hear and answer all our prayers. As we say together, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, here on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now we have music from Susan, Debbie, Barbara, and Beth. Side of your bulletin where the Eighth chapter of Isaiah is written. Here's a situation. The Syrian army, led by their king Rezin, and the northern 10 tribes of Israel. Israel has been divided. The northern 10 tribes have all gone together. They are against the southern two tribes, Judah and Benjamin. And so they have a divided country, divided tribes. And the northern tribes are siding with the Syrians against their brothers in the south, okay? Against Jerusalem. And what they really want to do is force Jerusalem and the Jewish kingdom down south to join with them so they can fight against the Assyrians. Let's just read this. Isaiah the prophet, the Lord said to me, take a large scroll and write on it with an ordinary pen, Mar Shalal Hashbaz. And so I called in Uriah the priest and Zechariah the son of Jerubbaal as reliable witnesses for me. And then I made love to the prophetess. Okay, he went into his wife, the prophetess. And she conceived and gave birth to a son. And the Lord said to me, name him Maher Shalal Hashbaz, which means swift to the spoil and fly to the booty. It says, for before the boy knows how to say, my father or my mother, the wealth of Damascus, the plunder of Samaria, will be carried off by the king of Assyria. We'll stop there and we'll pray. Father, thank you for your holy word. And our Heavenly Father, the things that were true in ancient Israel are just as true today as they ever were. In fact, from all eternity, there is truth. And when we align ourselves with your will, when we trust you for things that we may not even understand, we find ourselves standing in strength and in hope and in a good place. But all too often, Father, we find ourselves distracted by the things of this world and worry about what this one is doing, what that one's doing. We get ourselves caught up and we forget about you. We end up fearing and serving the things of this world. Our Heavenly Father, would you please speak to us about these things, that we might let you be the Lord of our life and not let your throne be taken over by those things we fear, those things we dread, the things we love, the things we enjoy, whatever it may be. Would you please speak to us about these things here this morning? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Isaiah had a couple children, actually. He just got through naming one back in chapter 7, Emmanuel. We celebrate that every Christmas. God with us. And the prophecy was back in chapter 7 that before that little child named Emmanuel was old enough to eat curds and honey, by then the things that you fear will be gone. Isaiah kept telling the people, don't be scared of Syria. Don't be scared of those northern 10 tribes, Ephraim, if you will. They're not your problem. But the Jewish people couldn't get that through their heads. And that was all they thought about. That reminds me of a pair of jean shorts that I own. I was in the trunk, I think. I got this cedar chest my mother gave years ago. And I put my winter clothes in there, and then I put summer clothes in the winter in there. Well, last spring, I took out the summer clothes, and I realized there was a fresh, very good pair of jean shorts in there that still fit well. So I took them out, and I thought, oh, this is great. But I had to do something on the car, right? There was a problem in there. And let's see, I guess what I needed was a new battery. So I got the old battery out, went down to Frank, he tested it. We could charge it, but you really need a new battery. You got one? Oh yeah. Put it in the quick charge, get the battery all ready, bring it home. Time to put it back in the car. Well, you know how these cars are nowadays under the hood. There's a steel post here. You can unbolt that and take that out, get that out of the way. Okay, good. Now the battery will fit in good. Well, no, it won't. You can't just drop the battery in. What you have to do is turn it, twist it, get it sideways, squeeze it in, pull this hose out of the way all at the same time and get it in. Meanwhile, I'm dripping battery acid on my beautiful blue shorts. And to this day, I don't wear them now, but they got these funky looking holes right around the crotch area, if you will. And on the side, brand new beautiful shorts. And you know whose the problem is? You know whose fault that is? That's General Motors engineers. Because they don't know what they're doing. They're just, they have all the education in the world, but they're dumbbells. They won't design a car that you can put a battery in. You know what the real problem is? Alan Rupert is very impatient. And what's so funny about that? Alan Rupert says to himself, you know what? Instead of taking that hose off, like you should, instead of taking this component off, taking a little time, get it out of the way so you could properly put the battery in, slide it into place, bolt it down, lock it up, put the contacts on, and then go back. I can't take the time to do that. So I'm going to put that battery in sideways. Our problems very often aren't what they think we think they are. It's not General Motors. When General Motors engineers put their heads together and they take a car that weighs close to 4,000 pounds and they put plastic on it, right? And I'm thinking to myself, when I was a kid growing up, we had steel bumpers with real chrome. That's the way a car ought to be. It ought to have steel bumpers with real chrome. And all these plastic body panels, how cheap and foolish it is to put them on. We had real steel cars. They only got 9 miles to the gallon, but they look so good. When General Motors can put together a car that weighs close to 2 tons, and that car just gets 25 miles to the gallon all around town, something you wouldn't have dreamt about when you were back in the day. They're geniuses. When they could take a 6-cylinder engine and get more power out of that than they used to get out of 454s and these big block motors, that's impressive. But when I'm inconvenienced, I don't like it at all. Yeah, the problem is not often, or not always, what it is. Sometimes patience is the problem. We don't want to do what we need to do to get the thing done right. We don't want to take time. And so we do the shortcut. We take the low road and end up making more time for ourselves and making it worse. Or maybe we're too cheap. Maybe that's our problem. Not General Motors. Not the Ford Motor Company, not Chrysler. Maybe it's we're too cheap. Maybe we think to ourselves, cheap. Instead of paying what it really costs to get this thing done right, let's do a patchy halfway job that won't really be right, probably hurt us down the road, end up costing in the long run more than it should have cost, but at least we get through today cheaply. We do that all the time in so much of our life. Or maybe confidence is the problem. Maybe we'll look at those components under the hood and think to ourselves, gee, if I start taking all that apart, maybe I won't be able to get it back together. Or we start taking a look at our lives. And we start thinking, maybe if I start making changes in the way I behave, maybe the people around me won't appreciate that. Maybe I'll lose my friends. Maybe I'll lose relationships. Maybe it'll cost me something. Which, if that's the case, are those the friends you really want? Are those the relationships you really want? You got it. But what do? All too often, let's just take the shortcut. Let's just take the low road. Let's get there as fast, as cheap, and as easy as we can. And you know what? We make our lives worse than they need to be. There's another part of this passage here. I love that. The Lord spoke to me again. Because this people has rejected the gently flowing waters of Shiloh. What a wonderful phrase. The gently flowing waters of Shiloh. The gently flowing waters of peace. Okay? And yet rejoices over Rezin, the son of Remaliah. Those kings up the road. Therefore, the Lord is about to bring against them the mighty flood waters of the Euphrates, the king of Assyria, with all its pomp, and it will overflow all its channels, run over all its banks, sweep on into Judah, swirling over it, passing through it, reaching up to the neck. Its outspread wings will cover the breadth of your land, Emmanuel. What a passage. How about the gently flowing waters of Shiloh? That refers to a stream that came into Jerusalem. It would go under the wall and into Jerusalem, so if an enemy nation attacked Jerusalem, they would still have water in the city. They could take refuge inside the city, behind the city walls, and still have water. And the Lord kept telling them, before these children of Isaiah's get old enough to know what's going on, the thing you're scared to death about is going to be gone. The thing you're worried about, that's not your problem. Assyria is your problem, but you're all focused on this. And I've sent my prophets, and I sent my apostles, and I said, listen to me. You need to trust me. I know what you think you see, but that's not your problem. You need to trust me. Those countries up there that you're scared to death of, they're going to be nothing. Damascus is going to be run over and destroyed within 65 years. And the 10 tribes up north, they're going to fall with just a few years, about 9 years evidently. And they'll be gone. But the people of Jerusalem wouldn't trust those peaceful flowing waters of Shiloh. And so they would be overflowed by the power of the Euphrates River. The Assyrians would come down upon them. You know, again, this just speaks to me. And we have specific issues in our life, like an unforgiving spirit. You know how powerful an unforgiving spirit is? We pray the Lord's Prayer all the time, don't we? And we say what? Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Literally a correlation. Lord, would you forgive me the same way I forgive others? That's a pretty dangerous prayer to pray now, isn't it? We pray it all the time. Do we think about it all the time? And worse yet, do we practice it all the time? An unforgiving spirit. And what we do is we say, you know what? I know this is wrong. I know I shouldn't do this. So I'm going to stop doing it. And I'm not going to be that way anymore. And the next time we get stepped on, it springs right back up. we pull these things out, but we don't pull them out by the roots. How about anger or short fuse? How powerful? How powerful is anger? Say a person's anger, right? It's like a city without walls, it's defenseless. When your anger takes over you, what do? You do stupid things, you do hurtful things. When anger happens to you in your house, okay? And that passion rises, and you talk to people who you live with, who you should love, right? You say terrible things to them. Trying to hurt them, hurt you, or hurt them as much as you. And you don't even know you're doing it. You just do it. It just comes up in you. It just is an anger problem that has a short fuse, and when it gets lit, you blow. You hurt the people you love the most, and break up families, and ruin situations that are God-given. So we say, I'm not going to get mad ever again. I've done it one too many times. I've had it now. I'm going to never get mad again. Or I'm never going to eat another potato chip for the rest of my life. And it only takes one Lay's to blow that up. And it only takes one short little issue to send the anger through the roof and pop the cork. How about intolerance? You know, that's a powerful thing. We can't stand people who are different than us. People who think differently than us. We're in the middle of a thing in the country. I mean, we have people in our lives that look at politics from the exact opposite perspective. And you know what? Think about it. When there was a civil war, right? There was the Mason-Dixon line. The enemy was geographically divided. Votes were taken, states made their case, and it fell in line. We have a civil war today. Who's the enemy? Who are you going to shoot? Who are you going to attack? Right across the street? Your sister? Put those faces in your mind. I mean, my sister thinks exactly opposite the way I do politically. So am I going to what? My smoker. Sister? Huh?
Smoker.
Blow her away! That's right. Teach her a lesson she'll not soon forget. And let the rest of the world know that I ain't messing around. I'm here to take over. And I can't do it because you can't buy ammunition. Okay. I mean, that's a terrible thing. You go down to the store here, all I want is some 30-30 shells. They haven't had them down there for months, and they won't. Called, what is it, Field and Stream? They don't have 30-30s. They used to be everywhere, all over the place. Go to Walmart, buy as many as you want. They're nowhere. But if I could hoard up and get 500 rounds together and hold up in that parsonage, and when they come to get me, I'm ready with all 500. How far is that gonna get me? It's kind of comical, isn't it? I ain't gonna hold out very long. Probably one smoke bomb is all it's gonna take, and I lose. And I show up for the war. I show up for battle. I've had enough. We need to take this back. And I stand out in the street with that 30-30. And I'm standing all by myself.
A little bit of tear gas and you're done.
That's right. Yeah, one canister of tear gas and all of a sudden it's like, all right, what do you want me to do? Work it. You know what I'm saying? We live in a country we're divided by what? Ideas. Ideas are the most divisive things on the planet Earth. Ideas are why nations go to war. Ideas are why people despise each other. But I'm not going to blow my sister away, because I can't. I don't have any ammo. I love my sister. And she spent most of her life hearing that she was probably the smartest of the Rupert kids. Now, I'm not going to burst that bubble on her, okay? But I love my sister. She's a good person. She's just like me. She was raised in the same house by the same parents. Made the same mistakes. I love her. Instead of despising her because she disagrees with me, one day we sat at my mother's table and we started to discuss this. This was years ago even. And within three volleys, I said, I think I was the first one to say, you know what, this goes nowhere because your arguments are my arguments. And she says, I know. So we just don't discuss that anymore. Intolerance can blow your household up. And over what? Over what that you don't have control over? Over what that's greater than us? And over who? Mom and Dad? What if your kids, what if you get in a big row with your kids and they won't come home and talk to you anymore, or you get mad and don't want to talk to them anymore because the election didn't turn out the way you wanted or the way they wanted? That's a pretty big price to pay. That's called intolerance. And then there's the undisciplined life. The life that won't put itself in order. The life that can't put three good days together. The life that can't say, you know what, I have certain habits in my life that are making my life so difficult. And they're hurting. I'm reading that Mike Lindell, the My Pillow Guy's book. And it's fascinating. That guy was a terrible, what do they call it? Not cocaine, but what's it when they turn it into a rock?
Crack.
Crack cocaine, yeah, right. He was a terrible crackhead. Blew up his family. He had this gift. I mean, he kept putting businesses together. He had companies. He was well into the MyPillow thing, building it up. Which, how big is that doggone thing now? I mean, that guy owns half of America. He even convinced us to get a MyPillow, which I will up to this moment recommend. Still really good. But it's got a 10-year guarantee. But I want to see if that thing will be good in 9 or 10 months. Then we'll see how good MyPillow is. Up till now, it's great. It does what it's supposed to do. But he was a terrible crackhead. And he talks about, just extensively in this book, the terrible lengths he would go to get high. In the cost of his family, the cost of his home. He says, I came home one day and realized we were living in an absolute pigsty. And me and my wife, we just had no discipline. Well, what do? I've been there, not with crack, but with cocaine, pot and booze and all that. And I quit about 100,000 times, but it never lasted past 7:30 that night.
Quitting,
so what do you do?
It's not the problem, it's staying quit with something.
Say that again?
It's not quitting that's the problem, it's staying quit that's the issue.
That's right, it's easy to quit, but it's hard to stay quit.
Right.
What's your problem? Is it crack cocaine? What's your problem? Is it the unforgiving spirit? What's your problem? Your real problem is your relationship with God. That's the source of all power to break all those bonds. That's the source of power to break all those chains. You can't do it. The power of sin will run rampant through your life and through this world until Jesus returns. Well, when I was saved, when I was, 8 years old, 12 years old, 16 years old, I got saved. Great. You need to. But you need to follow, obey, and be a disciple to get the benefits of that salvation down here. You can't just say a sinner's prayer and never change. You say that sinner's prayer, you commit your life to Christ, you become what is called a disciple, a follower. You find yourself sitting at his feet, listening to him, reading his word. Well, Reverend, I can't understand all that. Oh, okay, great. You know what you do? Get you one of those Daily breads. They're at the back of the church and they're free. And every day there's a little passage of scripture in there, and there's a little story about how that passage of scripture changed or affected somebody's life. And there's a little quotable quote at the bottom. That's how people learn the Bible. They start reading that a little bit at a time. You can't, Reverend, I'm going to read the Bible. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And then we get to towns for the Levites, cities of refuge. Caleb, the son of Jephunneh from the tribe of Judah. Shemuel, son of Aminahud from the tribe of Simeon. Eladad, son of Kishon from the tribe of Benjamin. Uki, son of Jogli from the tribe of Dan. What does that mean in my life for today? What's so funny? That's where reading programs go to die, in some of these Old Testament genealogies and books. So what do? Get that daily bread. Just read that little page every day. Say to yourself, for the rest of my life, before I do anything, I'm going to read that little page every day. And I'm going to ask God to help me understand it. And I'm going to think about it. And I tell you, these things will start to come clear in your mind. You'll start to make sense. And you'll start seeing in a little book like that Daily Bread, wow, he's just like me. This guy has the same family issues that I have. This guy has the same discipline problem. This guy has the same anger issues. These people are all just like me. Wow, I'm going to go and keep doing this. Make it a habit. It'll change your life. We want to take care of symptoms, but we need to get to the root of the disease. And it's all about our relationship with Christ. We either need to enter into that. How do you get in a relationship with Jesus? How do you become a Christian? Man, Billy Graham probably led more people to the Lord, maybe in the history of the world, Jesus included. When Jesus went to the cross, when the smoke cleared, there was, what, 120 in the upper room? The day of Pentecost, it was 3,000. Billy Graham had people just coming to the altar. And you know what? We got his books back here in the library. I got his books. You know how complicated they are? They're not. It's as simple as can be. Billy Graham talked about things that any man, woman, or child can understand and you see every day. And he said, you know what, Jesus is a solution to your problem. And explained how all you need to do is say, Lord, I need you to be my Lord. I need you to be my Savior. I confess I am a sinner, and without you, Lord, I'm lost. I'll never ever be what I should be. I'll never ever be what I could be. I'll never ever have what I could have. Lord, I'm going to trust you. Would you please be my Savior? And you know what the answer is? On every doggone page of the Bible, the answer is yes. He who comes to me, I will in no wise cast out. In fact, he's the one handing out the invitation, saying, come unto me, all you labor and are heavy laden. Take my yoke upon you. Learn about me. That word learn, that's disciple. Right? I read Glenn's paper. I don't want to give away your age. Okay? 50 years ago, he wrote a
I told
term
everybody
paper.
I'm 76 now.
Pardon?
I tell everybody I'm now 76.
That's right. And it was wonderful. It was so understandable. It was clear. It was well written. It was well thought out. It was very impressive. And it's all about teaching. Because that's the other side. Okay, we have teachers to teach disciples. Disciples are learners. Somebody who wants to learn about the Lord. You can come to church. You come to this church. We'll explain the Bible every single Sunday, okay? We'll go online every single night at 7:30, German PMC, Facebook, and explain the Bible. And little by little, you can take that daily bread and read it. And then one day you can say to yourself, I want to tackle a book of the Bible. And you could sit down and read the Gospel of John or the Gospel of Matthew. And do you realize what a heavyweight thing you just did? I mean, that's the Word of God. This is the all-time piece of literature in the history of the world. God speaks through those books. You read the Gospel of John, you've done something people have been doing for generations, and something that John the Apostle wrote and translated in our language. And that's all stuff you can do to draw yourself closer to the Lord, to help you with these symptoms that aren't really the problem. This is what the Lord says to me with his strong hand upon me. He's warning me not to follow the way of this people. Don't call conspiracy everything this people calls a conspiracy. Don't fear what they fear. Don't worry about those Syrians up the road. Don't worry about the kingdom of Ephraim up the road. Think about me, God says. Worry about me. I'll take care of you. You know, he told Moses thousands of years ago, if you'll walk with me, if you'll obey me, I'll chase your enemies away. Your enemies will become my enemies. Your adversaries will become my adversaries. We will walk together through this world, and I will walk with you. Don't worry about the problems. Worry about the solution. Embrace the solution. Don't fear what they fear, and don't dread it. The Lord Almighty is the one you are to regard as holy. He's the one you are to fear. He's the one you are to dread. He will be a holy place for both Israel and Judah. You mean those sinful, fallen, idolatrous nations that disobeyed God in everything they did? Those nations that took the gold out of the temple to build idols with? Yeah, those sinful nations. Because those sinful nations are us. But the good news is, forgiveness is that the gospel's all about. It's forgiveness. It's not your perfection. It's not your righteousness. It's not your justice. You don't have that. What you can get is forgiveness that cleanses the human soul and opens a relationship up with God that brings solutions to the problems. He will be a holy place both for Israel and Judah. He will be a stone that causes people to stumble and a rock that makes them fall. Remember, they applied that specifically to Jesus, didn't they? They said, on this stone, he'll stumble. The people who looked at Jesus, who were all tied up in themselves, couldn't see Jesus for who he was. They were so worried about protecting their interests, their power, their wealth, their influence, that they looked at the very Son of God and thought, if we kill him, just think, if we kill this man who has all the powers, he's demonstrating all the powers of God, he stills the storm, he multiplies bread, he heals the sick, he gives life to the dead, he takes bread and causes it to multiply. But if we kill him, he won't be able to bother us anymore. If we kill God, he won't be able to bother us anymore. We can keep our influence, we can keep our power, and we can keep our authority, and we can keep our wealth, and we will lose everything. Because on the third day he rose again. Yeah, he'll be a stumbling stone and a rock that makes them fall. And for the people of Jerusalem, he'll become a trap and a snare. Many of them will stumble. They will fall and be broken and will be snared and captured. So bind up this testimony of warning and seal up God's instruction among my disciples. I will wait for the Lord. He's hiding his face from the descendants of Jacob. He is hiding his face from the descendants of Jacob. I will wait for the Lord, who is hiding his face from the descendants of Jacob. And though he is hiding his face, I will put my trust in him. Here am I, and the children the Lord has given me. Emmanuel, Mar Shalal Ishbaz. The child named God with us, and the child who symbolizes the swift downfall of our enemies that we need not fear. We are signs and symbols in Israel from the Lord Almighty who dwells on Mount Zion. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your holy word. Because, Lord, we're just regular people down here in this world, and we do get distracted. You know that better than anyone. The things of this world cause this way and that way, and we get concerned and worried about them. Or we fall in love with the things of this world and find ourselves not paying much attention to you. But the solution is to turn back. That's why it's called repentance. It's turning back away from those things and turning back to you. The source of forgiveness. Because when we fall in love with the things of the world, when we fear the things of the world, we find all kind of symptoms cropping up in our lives that are destructive and debasing and humiliating, shrinking. What we really need to do is draw close to you and walk with you here in this world and find a God who loves us. Find a God who's taught us that Jesus loves us, this we know, just because the Bible tells us so. Find a God who says, I long to forgive you. I want to embrace you. I want to take you up on eagle's wings and bring you to heights that you never dreamed possible. Father, speak to us about these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, let us turn in our hymnals to 317. 317. Let's all stand and be saved. Well, that thing burned down. But in 1895, they put the cornerstone in this building. Here we are today, like our ancestors, fathers and mothers in Christ. And we're here to learn about you, Lord. Would you please continue to minister to us? Would you continue to teach us? Would you be our Lord and Savior? Thank you that your answer is yea and amen. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.